This is the day you've been waiting for. The sun is shining, the birds are singing, and you know just what you want to do.
All you want to do is ride around Saturday.
This being the gift-giving season, I have a special gift for you, my dear listeners. Hi, everybody. Rick Lamb here for The Horse Show. What is that gift, you say? Well, it's the very best radio program that I can give you. And, of course, I'm very proud of our radio show every week. But this week in particular, I think you're really going to enjoy it. First up is Donna Snyder-Smith. Donna, I've known for quite some time, and she is one of those people, relatively few people in the horse industry, who kind of bridges gaps, I guess is the best way I can describe it. She is an accomplished teacher of centered riding, which is very popular in the English world. She is an endurance riding expert and has written on that subject, and she is a big proponent of natural horsemanship, which, of course, is very big in the Western world. So she kind of brings all these factions together with her message. Today she's going to talk about balance, balance in the horse, balance in the rider, and how we can achieve that. Caught up with her at the Western States Wild Horse and Burro Expo. Next up are a couple, or is a couple, that is very unusual in the horse industry because they are both clinicians. They work together. They teach the same message. Doug and Kathy Voschel are my guests, and they have an unusual story, and I think you're going to enjoy meeting them toward the end of our program today. I want to remind you about my website, thehorseshow.com. Now, if you can't get our radio or TV programs when they're originally broadcast, you can listen to them on demand, watch them on demand through our website, thehorseshow.com. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show, and we'll be back. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here, and I have some great news to share with you today. ADM Alliance Nutrition Premium Horse Feeds, the kind I use and recommend, are now available at True Value stores all across the U.S. You can order online and pick up at your local store. It's that easy, and there's never a shipping charge. Here's what I want you to do. Visit TrueValue.com. You'll see a little search window there. Enter ADM, and it'll take you right to the page where you can order. The ADM premium horse products available through True Value are Senior Glow, Prime Glow, Ultra Fiber, Grow Strong Vitamin Mineral, and Forage First Horse Rewards. Remember, these are scientifically formulated products built around ADM's Forage First philosophy. And now you can get them through your local True Value store. You know, I didn't think ADM could do any more for the horse, but they've done it by partnering with True Value stores. Visit TrueValue.com and search on ADM. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse. You know, the time I spend with horses is the best part of my day, and I'm not going to put that at risk. That's why I look for products with the Farnam label. For more than 65 years, Farnam has been providing essential horse care products like fly control, deworming, grooming, hoof and leg care, wound care, leather care, stable supplies, and nutritional supplements. Find out for yourself what Farnam has to offer at FarnamHorse.com. Farnam, your partner in horse care. Never tie your horse again. Use the Safe Clip instead. The Safe Clip from Smart Tie is the ultimate horse tying system and training tool, and you can take it with you wherever you go. Here's how it works. Fold your lead rope and insert the loop in the clip. Adjust the length, then adjust the tension. If your horse spooks, he can get relief without coming untied. The Safe Clip from Smart Tie, great for the barn, trailer, cross ties, and high lines, anywhere you would tie a horse. Learn more about the Safe Clip at smarttieproducts.com.
Every month, there's hands-on advice from the pros in Horse and Rider, the how-to magazine for Western riding. Call now and get 2 years for the price of one, just $24. 1-800-829-3340.
As you can imagine, I get inundated with horse magazines and books every single month. I always make time to read Horse and Rider. It is the how-to magazine for Western riding. Wouldn't do without it. Call 1-800-829-3340 and say Rick Lamb sent you.
Hard work comes with a lot of sweat. That's why there's new Wrangler Cool Vantage jeans. They keep you cool by wicking sweat 5 times faster. They keep you dry by pulling moisture to the outside where it dries faster. They keep you comfortable so you're less restricted all day long. New Wrangler Premium Performance Cool Vantage jeans. The newest innovation in comfort.
And now, back to the Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
All right, welcome back, everybody. Coming to you today from the Western States Wild Horse and Burro Expo in Reno, Nevada. I'm Rick Lamb. This is the Horse Show Live, brought to you by Daily 72. And I'm very happy to have with me my friend Donna Snyder-Smith. Donna, nice to see you again.
Good to see you again, Rick.
You've changed your look a bit. You've got this wonderful Western, like Cowboys and Indians magazine look happening.
Well, thank you very much. It's fun to play with different things.
Well, you've got a very rich background in a lot of different aspects of riding horses and teaching horsemanship, and we're going to pick your mind just a little bit today.
Okay.
About a topic I know is very important to you, and that's balance. Balance in both rider and horse. You have a strong interest and expertise in endurance riding. You're also a centered riding instructor.
That's correct.
So you come to this with a lot of valuable information. How do you define balance?
Excellent question. In relationship to the rider, I define it as the rider being able, on a moment-to-moment basis, staying in the horse's center of gravity, both longitudinally and laterally. So not only must they be balanced in their own body in order to accomplish that, but then we have the added dimension of the horse's, you know, undulating surface and, of course, what it's doing across the ground with its feet. So that gives us about three layers going on there. And then in order to be balanced, that rider has to stay in the center of that horse's gravity. Or if they elect to go out of the center, it's a deliberate choice to influence the horse.
So that's the rider. How do you define balance as far as a horse is concerned?
There's something called, which I call natural balance, and then educated balance. Natural balance is what you'll see the Mustangs displaying when they come off a hill in those, you know, beautiful films of them running down mountain slopes over, you know, boulders the size of my head and at 90 miles an hour. And, you know, I'm looking at that thinking there's no way in God's green earth you could get me to ride a horse under those circumstances.
And perfect yet, lead changes.
Exactly.
Back and forth.
Exactly.
Flawless.
Right. And yet they do it. So that's one type of balance for the horse. But then we bring the element of the rider to the horse. And biomechanically speaking, the horse was not designed to carry the rider. They're strong enough to do it in many cases, but they weren't designed to do it. So as a consequence, when we bring that element to the horse, we have to re-educate the horse in self-carriage. In other words, how it has to carry its own skeleton, with which muscle groups it has to operate so that that skeleton is preserved through a long period of time and, you know, they end up at 25 being sound and comfortable and not crippled or in the killers.
I like what you said just a few moments ago to the audience here as you gave your presentation. You pointed out that horses are pushing machines. Their power, as we know, comes from the back end, but it's to power them forward. They're not really designed as carrying machines.
Exactly. So that's something that not everybody is aware of. And when you take over a partnership or begin a partnership with a horse, in my opinion, that it falls upon you to understand that you are now your horse's gym coach or your horse's personal trainer, if you will. Okay, and you've got to educate yourself not only in what you have to do when you're on the horse's back, but what you have to get your horse to do to work out on the right gym machines, okay? So he has to understand, he has to work those muscles that carry, not just push, all right? And the more he carries, the lighter the front end gets. As a result of that, we have two things that come off of that. One, most performance disciplines like a light front end. They like a front end that's very controllable, easily movable, etc. And then the other thing that comes off of that is the horse is not transferring its weight into the ground in a concussive manner, or at least it's in a much less concussive manner, and that funnels into how long they stay sound.
Let's talk about how we can further both of these goals, balance in the horse and balance in the rider. We don't have a whole lot of time for this, but maybe you can give us some ideas, because this is not only a training task, this is a conditioning of muscles sort of a task. How would you help the rider become more conditioned to be balanced?
There are classical rider exercises, but let's start with understanding how your body is functioning in your daily living. That's a big step for most people, because I often teach in front of mirrors, because when I position their body in the way that is most advantageous to good riding, they'll swear, without allowing to look in the mirror, they will swear to me on a stack. I could win a lot of money this way, okay? Because they would swear to me on a stack of Bibles that their body is in a certain position. And I ask them to look in the mirror, and they're just totally blown away. So the most basic answer to your question is you have to start from the beginning. You've got to start with knowing what you're doing now. And that doesn't come necessarily easy because of something we call a distorted kinesthetic sense. Okay.
Meaning, if I could guess at what that means, would that mean, like I have a tendency maybe sometimes to kind of walk a little bit more forward.
Right.
And my wife will say, stand up straight. You're kind of hunching, especially as I get tired.
Right.
To me, it feels normal.
Yes.
That's my distorted kinesthetic sense.
That is indeed your distorted kinesthetic sense.
And how do you change that, though, when that feels right to them to walk that way or carry themselves that way?
Excellent question. It does take some work. And the quickest way to change it is, again, start on the ground in front of a mirror. The way to change it on horseback is either to have somebody video you on a regular basis. Obviously, to get the services of a perceptive coach who can tell you when things are not in the right place, or, as the Europeans have done for, you know, hundreds of years, do some of your educational riding in halls with mirrors, mm-hmm. so that you are constantly 360 degrees surround of looking at yourself. So while your mind is telling you that you're sitting up straight, as you look in the mirror, you're going to see that, in fact, you are not on the vertical line. You are in that hunch that feels comfortable, quote unquote.
Then presumably with enough practice at that, you can develop a new comfort place where being correct feels correct.
Absolutely. Maxwell Maltz, a long time ago in his book Psycho-Cybernetics, you know, said 28 days. And the Chinese, when they did their investigative analysis of their gymnastic program, basically said 2,000 repetitions. So somewhere between 2,000 repetitions and 28 days, and that will reprogram, you know, that map in your mind.
You've got to want this. You've got to want it pretty bad to put in that kind of effort to change what feels right, correct? Do you ever find people that just say, you know, that's just too hard?
Oh, all the time. All the time. And you do have to want it. But that gives me an opportunity to talk about the title of your book and your book in point of fact, The Revolution in Horsemanship, which I like a lot and now recommend to my clients because we have what we call a base library. I educate a lot of people from the ground up, and I'm a big fan of studying beyond when you're sitting on the horse, mm-hmm. right? And I also have a strong feeling about knowing your history will give you a broader contextual view of the industry, which in turn then gives you a better position from which to make your choices.
Right.
Because good practice makes perfect, not practice makes
right.
perfect. In truth, we are seeing a revolution. We have been seeing it for a number of years now. But it's focused on the horse in the sense of the horse training, kinder, gentler approach. Learn to read the horse's body language, talk to the horse in a language that it understands. We still have to get on their back, and you know what? We're still talking to them. If you've learned to do all that on the ground, and then you put your foot in the saddle and you step up, and now your body is giving them primarily white noise with a couple of shouted commands. You know, some of the horses are quiet enough in their mind to just overcome it and ignore the rest of it. But many of those horses are not that emotionally stable, and they go off the deep end.
Plus, there's virtually no chance of taking your riding to a higher level. You might survive the ride, but if you want to be better at it,
that's it. Absolutely. You've got it.
From the Western States Wild Horse and Burro Expo, this is the Horse Show Live, brought to you by Daily 72. When we return, questions from the audience for Donna Snyder-Smith. I'm Rick Lamb. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Hey, everybody. Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a travel-in corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pen. 8 panels make an 18-foot round pen. Second reason I'm crazy about travel-in corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel In Corrals. Travel, the letter in, corrals.com. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the 5 very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com. From the Western States Wild Horse and Burro Expo, this is the Horse Show Live, brought to you by Daily 72. I'm Rick Lamb, and we have questions for Donna Snyder-Smith. Any comments you'd like to add to this?
Oh, she wants to talk. She's grabbing the microphone.
I think that balanced riding and talking with your horse, communicating with the horse, is everything. And I've seen Donna over the last 20 years work with endurance riders and improve the quality of endurance riders. And I really give her a lot of credit for doing that. I'm really glad she's here.
Well, Donna, and I'm not trying to embarrass you, but Donna is one of those people that bridges many of the gaps that kind of exist within the horse industry, because she's a proponent, as you've just heard, of natural horsemanship, which is what I write about and talk about most, and centered riding, which is very firmly ensconced in the English side of things, and making inroads, of course, in Western riding. So she's one of those people that's tying it all together. Comments?
Well, I'm just new into the sport, equestrian sport, and the next project for me is to learn better balance. And this has helped me a great deal with knowing where to look, knowing where to turn. I, you know, read about 15 books when I first was kind of thrust into this by my kids. And I've learned about the horse enough to get by. Now I need to learn about riding. And this has helped me a great deal.
Rick, can I add something here?
Absolutely.
A year ago, after 3 years worth of work with the Synergist Saddle people, we put together a video. And basically the reason they got me to put together the video was because they were making saddles to fit horses' backs. Horses were having a problem when the saddle came back. What was found out was it wasn't the saddle that was creating the problem, it was the position of the rider. So basically they said to me, please, 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 please get something down in film so we can send this off to our customers with the saddles, so they'll have some hope of, you know, at home in the privacy of their own home, being able to start to take, like you said, what can we do to begin to change this? And that video is now done and available. I have some with me here, and it's also available through the Synergist Saddles, and it's called Partners, The Art of Mounted Body Language. And it was specifically made for people with the intent that they would not be able to attend a clinic, that they would not have access to an instructor, and it's laid out rather slowly, especially initially when we're working with that distorted kinesthetic sentence in the front of a mirror, which we do with a person so the audience, the person watching, can see that.
Is there a common mistake that people tend to make that was meant to address?
Absolutely. The most common mistake is tension in the low back, right, which freezes the pelvis into a position which is adversarial to the movement of the horse.
Well, you know, when I wrote about this, and see if you just agree with this way of describing it, I describe the pelvis as kind of a multi-directional shock absorber. If it's working correctly, it should be kind of following the horse while your upper body kind of remains fairly static.
That works for me. I have a tendency, being a specialist, to break it down a little bit finer than that.
Okay.
So the spine above the pelvis is what's actually acting to allow the pelvis to be that multidimensional following tool.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so in that you are right. The pelvis must follow fluidly. But it's actually the spine just above the pelvis that either allows that or shuts it down.
The lower back.
Exactly, lower back. So if you have a tight lower back or pain in your lower back, or you're one-sided, in other words, you have a curl in your body, one shoulder lower than the other, all of those things shut down that pelvis and prevent it from moving. As soon as you get it to move freely, then you actually begin the journey, because the journey is using it for the communication tool. That's the number one communication tool. It speeds your horses up. It slows your horses down. It'll turn your horse right. It'll turn your horse left. And it'll help sit your horse on its hind feet. The hands and the legs are all auxiliary tools.
Yeah. And you've always got your pelvis on the horse. If you're riding them, you've always got your use of your pelvis.
Yes.
You don't always have use of your hands or even your legs sometimes.
Right.
Any other comments? Linda, you want to make a comment?
I do have a lower back problem. What do you suggest for someone like myself, who I tend to get tense in my lower back because I'm afraid it's going to hurt?
Well, my suggestion, honestly, would be to view the video and try that in front of the mirror yourself. What I find very frequently in my clinics is that people come to me, they don't realize how to position their pelvis in the neutral spine position, which is basically with the pelvis on the vertical. All right, they don't realize they're already in a state of contraction and pain. And so when I show them how to get out of that state, suddenly they feel these releases and this, you know, this reduction of pain, and now they're not in the state, you know, they're not in the situation that you just said. They're not afraid they're going to be, it's going to be painful, because they've just experienced that it's not. Now, there's a number of modalities that are available through, you know, non-horse related modalities, Alexander Feldenkrais, you know, good physical therapy, Hatha yoga, the one, core muscles. What am I trying to think of here? Thank you very much. Pilates to strengthen the core muscles. So if you don't even get close to a horse, you can do things to help that. But that is the core, that is where you must begin if you want to be a good rider, and if you want to be, more importantly, a good conscientious partner for your horse.
Do the principles of the DVD transfer to any saddle, or do you have to have a synergist saddle?
No, the principles of the DVD transfer to any saddle, any horse, and any discipline. Great. In other words, from reiners to ropers to endurance riders to dressage riders.
Thank you.
The follow-up question to that, all riding essentially the same?
All riding essentially the same. Your skeleton doesn't change when you stop riding the cutting horse and get on the dressage horse. And the horse's skeleton doesn't change when it stops being a roping horse and starts being a reining horse.
More that ties it together than separates it, then,
exactly,
as far as the disciplines are concerned.
Absolutely.
One last question, then unfortunately we're flat out of time for today. Men and women have different pelvises. They're structured differently. Does that affect how you teach them to supple that lower back?
No, because while the shape of the pelvis is, yes, different, and the width of it is different, the connection to the spine is not different.
Absolutely the same. And that's what we need to become flexible in that. That's
exactly
that shock absorber I was talking
exactly
about.
Exactly.
Absolutely. What is your website?
Just www.donnasnydersmith.com.
And that's S-N-Y-D-E-R.
It is.
And there's not a hyphen in the middle of that in the website, is there?
Yes.
There is. So
oh, no, I'm sorry. No, you're right.
Donna Snyder Smith all kind of run
all
together.
All run together, and then...
Because you're a hyphen normally.
Yes, I am.
Okay. Thank you all very much for coming. Enjoy your day here at the Western States Wild Horse and Burro Expo. Thank you, Donna, for being with us.
Thank you very much, Rick.
Still to come, the couple that works together stays together. Well, in this case, it's true. My guests are Doug and Kathy Voschel. They're going to talk to you about their wonderful and a little bit crazy life when the Horse Show Live continues. I'm Rick Lamb. Stay with us. Hey, everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a travel-in corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin. 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about travel-in corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter N, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel In Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com.
Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here, and I have some great news to share with you today. ADM Alliance Nutrition Premium Horse Feeds, the kind I use and recommend, are now available at True Value stores all across the U.S. You can order online and pick up at your local store. It's that easy, and there's never a shipping charge. Here's what I want you to do. Visit TrueValue.com. You'll see a little search window there. Enter ADM, and it'll take you right to the page where you can order. The ADM premium horse products available through True Value are Senior Glow, Prime Glow, Ultra Fiber, Grow Strong Vitamin Mineral, and Forage First Horse Rewards. Remember, these are scientifically formulated products built around ADM's Forage First philosophy. And now you can get them through your local True Value store. You know, I didn't think ADM could do any more for the horse, but they've done it by partnering with True Value stores. Visit TrueValue.com and search on ADM. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse. If you're like me, you need a pretty good reason to sit in front of a TV set these days. Hi everybody, Rick Lamb here. RFD TV is that reason. Finally, there's a network for people like you and me, people who care about the rural lifestyle, about livestock and tradition. RFD TV brings you family-friendly programming that entertains and educates and never ever offends. Every week you see the icons of country music with Ralph Emery, Crook and Chase, and Marty Stewart. You get some of the top horsemen in the world like Clinton Anderson, Chris Cox, Craig Cameron, and the Pirellis. And you get farm news and special features. Oh yeah, you get me too. So join me and the millions of other RFD TV viewers. Call your satellite or cable provider and ask for RFD TV, rural America's most important network. It's TV we can all be proud of. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com or give them a call at 615-227-9292.
Thank you for listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. If you have a question, request, or comment, we want to hear from you. Our fax number is area code 602-279-0980. Or if you would like to email us, the address is lambemail@aol.com. Now, back to Rick.
Welcome back, everybody. Coming to you today from Ride the West Horse and Ranch Expo in Spokane, Washington. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show Live, brought to you by Daily 72. I'm very happy to meet a couple I've heard about for some time. I've been looking forward to talking to them, Kathy and Doug Voschel. Folks, welcome to The Horse Show.
Thank you, Rick. It's nice to be here.
Thank you.
I want to explore the story of the Voschels. You're so cute. I mean, you're just like a team, a neat team. Because it's interesting from a number of standpoints. You're the only, I think, husband and wife, not the only, but one of the very few husband and wife clinician teams that I'm aware of. So I kind of want to explore how that happened. But Kathy, let's go back to the beginning and get a little bit of background on you personally, how you got interested in horses, how you got involved as a teacher.
Well, when I was young, my family, we lived in the suburbs and weren't able to have horses of our own. And I can remember my very earliest thought of what I wanted to be was when I was, believe it or not, 2 years old at the circus, and I saw the trainers, the horse trainers, and I knew then that that's what I wanted. And so as I grew up, and every time a trailer would go by down the road, I'd crane my neck and look and wish. And then at 10 years old, I got to start riding with my friend down the street. And at 12 years old, I actually started training and working with other people's horses that they didn't know what to do with. They were having problems, were afraid to ride them. And I just wanted to ride so bad, I rode them anyway, and it seemed to work out. I had the knack to do what was needed, and it just kind of went from there. I got my first horse when I was 15 years old. I'd stepped away from it for a little while to raise our family, and then came back into it again later on in life. And I was introduced actually to John Lyons by someone we purchased a thoroughbred from. He gave me an old article, an old magazine, A Perfect Horse. And I read that and I started reading it, and I really loved the way John approached training techniques. They were so easy to understand and actually something everyone could do. So I started getting all of his literature and just watching him at expos. Finally had the opportunity to meet him and found out about the certification program, and looked at my husband and said, I would like to go to that. And he looked at me and he said, okay, let's do it. And so we arranged it and I went, and it was an incredible experience, very intense program. Got to ride with John and Josh for 12 weeks and then came home. And Doug said, you know what? I like what I see. I want to do it too. And so he went, and it's just been a big part, a huge part of our life ever since.
Now, how long has it been since, I guess Doug became certified after you, since you've been a team of certified John Lyons trainers?
I was certified in 2003, mm-hmm. and Doug was certified in 2004.
Okay, so you've been out for, more, this is like your third year doing this then.
Right, together. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well, right. That is neat. Doug, grab the microphone. Give me your story.
My story is a little bit different than Kathy's. I got my first horse when I was 5 years old. It was an Appaloosa. Yep, he was green broke, and it wasn't a question of if he was going to buck me off, it was when. And so that's how I learned how to ride, was on one that at any moment could blow up. And eventually he calmed down, and then I got my second horse, which was Bergy, which was a little quarter horse that used to run barrels, and he was just a great horse. But all the way through high school, and then shortly after then, I had horses. And then again, I took a break and got back into horses. Oh, back, I think it was probably about 1997 or 98.
Well, you guys must have really had your hands full with raising eight kids. Well, I tip my hat to you, because I know what it, I had three kids to raise, and I know, and my wife did most of the work on that while I was working. So I know what's involved in that, and I have a sense that you're probably very, very good parents. How did you manage to combine this career with being parents to eight kids? Because you're not old enough for them all to be out of the house, I'm sure of that.
That's true. We still have three at home. We have our 15-year-old, Dallas, and then we have Johanna, and she is a senior in high school, be graduating in just a few weeks from now. And then we have Crystal, and she's 20, and she's going to Lane Community College in the Eugene area. So it's been tough at times. The kids all have horses of their own, and they take care of them. And I think it's really a great thing for parents to be involved in horses or a similar activity, because it's something you do together as a family. I mean, during the winter time when you go out and you know, 30-degree weather, and you got to go down and shovel stalls, rain, snow, whatever that might
be. Builds character.
It builds character, and it teaches them responsibility. And so I think it's a really good thing.
Now, do the older kids tend to help raising the younger kids? Is that how you work it when you have a huge family like that?
Well, they are all really close. They do take care of each other. Yeah. They're there for each other, and having eight kids, you got to have rules. You got to have, you know, some way to get everything done around the house and around the barn and the ranch. And so right from the start, we've always kind of set the ground rules, and they all pitch in. Everybody has a chore or a thing that they do every day, and it's all taken care of that way. And when we're gone, like we are now, and aren't able to bring them with us, the older kids that don't live at home are constantly checking in, stopping by to make sure that, you know, if they need anything, even though they're self-sufficient at home and they're driving and they're old enough to do that, they still all kind of watch out for each other. And
well,
it's really nice, that it's a comforting feeling while we're gone.
Now, I don't mean to be personal, but when you first got married, was this the plan to have eight kids? Did I mean, like, did Doug say, well, how do you feel about kids? Yeah, eight of them. Was
no,
that what happened?
No, it really wasn't a plan, but you know, I believe with all my heart that everything happens for a reason.
Yeah.
So.
Well, good for you. Well,
you forgot the three grandkids.
Oh yeah.
And three grandkids too.
Three grandkids. Well, our oldest is 33. So, not grandkid. Our oldest.
Well,
our
you guys
son
must
is
be
33.
Like drinking from the fountain of youth or something, because you don't look old enough to have any grandkids. Well, that is neat. Even on a personal level, that is a fascinating story. Let's talk a little bit about what you're doing in your careers now as clinicians. The thing that I like about John Lyons' program, among many things, is the fact that he gives you this core amount of training and teaching, and then says, go forth and do with it the best you can, and add your own twist to it, add your own ideas, rather than confining you to just teaching his stuff. Doug, what have you guys added to it?
You know, what's funny, Rick, is a lot of people, you know, they choose a trainer and they become, oh, I'm Pirelli or, oh, I'm Lyons or whatever. What's funny is, as Kathy mentioned, the way that we got involved with John was through an old weathered copy of Perfect Horse magazine that was given to us by Tim Quaid, who we brought an old thoroughbred from. So Kathy started collecting those, and now we have this wonderful thing called eBay that you can get all of the back issues. So Kathy has a complete and full library of all the John Lyons material, and she just fell in love with the techniques. But as with any type of education, the best way to learn is to have a teacher. Wouldn't you agree?
Sure.
And so that's basically what we needed, was to go through the certification program to really, really learn it good. At first, I was skeptical. I was raised old cowboy. Mm-hmm. You know, you get on them, buck them out, spur them in the belly, and go. When I saw Kathy go through the certification program, you know, after about the first session, I was beginning to scratch my head and say, you know, I think that there might be a better way to do this. By the end of the second session, I was like, this is unbelievable, because Kathy went through the cert program with a little Arab mare. Her name is Mary. She's Kathy's demo horse here at this expo, and she was just a pill. Now, Kathy, in the middle of the expo up in Canada that we just got done doing, lost a Chicago screw out of her bridle, and the whole bridle fell off. And there was a collective by the audience, and Kathy was, oh, it's no problem. She spent the next 45 minutes of the demo that we were doing bridleless, riding and helping students.
Okay,
that
Kathy, was that planned?
No,
it wasn't planned. Okay.
It was said, good for business, though.
It was good.
It should be so later, though.
A fortuitous accident worked out pretty well.
You're listening to The Horse Show Live with me, Rick Lamb, brought to you by Daily 72 from the Ride the West Horse and Ranch Expo in Spokane. My guests are Doug and Kathy Voschel. When we get back, we'll learn about the Extreme Trail Challenge.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is a copyrighted production of Lamb Chop Studios, Phoenix, Arizona. Unauthorized use is strictly prohibited.
Featherlite horse trailers are fit for your life and your horse. With safety features and unmatched durability, owning a Featherlite horse trailer gives you more value for the long haul. Aluminum Featherlights tow easier, look great, and keep your horses safe. Featherlight's redesigned light flow feed doors maximize airflow and light for your horse's comfort. Your horses deserve the best. See what's new and visit your Featherlight dealer today.
That's music to my ears. Hi, I'm Pat Pirelli.
And I'm Linda Pirelli. If you love everything about horses, the way they look, the way they sound, even the way they smell, well, you're among friends at RFD-TV.
RFD-TV has the most horse programs of any network on television, every day, all year long.
Take Pirelli Natural Horsemanship, for example. Each week, you'll learn how you and your horse can become recreation for each other, how training can be shaped to the personality or horsenality of your horse,
and how you can reach your horsemanship goals.
RFD-TV brings you family-friendly programming that educates, entertains, and inspires. It's TV we can all be proud of.
And it's available on satellite and cable systems throughout the country. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com.
Or call 615-227-9292.
RFD-TV and Pirelli Natural Horsemanship.
We're teaming up to make life better for you and your horse.
Make watering your horses automatic and absolutely safe with the Bar Bar A horse drinker. It's non-electric, and the bowl empties after every drink. That keeps the water warmer in winter and cooler in summer. Plus, you avoid breeding mosquitoes or algae. Right now, save 10% on the Bar Bar A horse drinker when you mention Rick Lamb. 10%. Call 800-451-2230 or visit horsedrinker.com. The Bar Bar A horse drinker. 800-451-2230 or horsedrinker.com. You know, the time I spend with horses is the best part of my day, and I'm not going to put that at risk. That's why I look for products with the Farnam label. For more than 65 years, Farnam has been providing essential horse care products like fly control, deworming, grooming, hoof and leg care, wound care, leather care, stable supplies, and nutritional supplements. Find out for yourself what Farnam has to offer at FarnamHorse.com. Farnam, your partner in horse care. top farriers, researchers, and veterinarians are coming together in Las Vegas December 3rd through 5th for the International Lameness Prevention Conference, and you're invited. Learn about the latest research on causes of lameness, state-of-the-art treatment protocols, and most important, how we can manage our horses to promote healthy hooves. The International Lameness Prevention Conference during the NFR in Las Vegas, December 3rd through 5th, brought to you by the Equine Lameness Prevention Organization. For more information, visit ilpc.info. The wait is over. You can now get the audio version of Human to Horseman. 5 hours on 4 standard audio CDs, just $24.95. Visit thehorseshow.com to order.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is here every week at this time. So tell a friend.
You know, that is the nicest thing that you can do for me. I don't need any Christmas present. Just tell somebody about our radio and television show and, of course, our website, thehorseshow.com. From Ride the West Horse and Ranch Expo in Spokane, Washington, this is The Horse Show Live, brought to you by Daily 72, and my guests are Doug and Kathy Voschel.
One of the things that you guys have kind of been associated with, at least at this event, and I think that was somewhat of an accident too, is this Extreme Trail Challenge. Kathy, talk a little bit about what that is, at least as it happens here at this event.
Well, what it is, it's actually an event that's designed to incorporate everybody so that everyone can participate no matter on what their level is. It's sort of an educational experience for them and a challenge all at the same time. We try to make sure that we focus on safety. But the backcountry horsemen have been fantastic with building the trail for us. They've done a great job with that. And
they're a pretty handy group, aren't they?
They really are, and they're a great, great group of people. And they're there helping out and just with a smile on their face every time, and they're just really nice to be around. We appreciate everything that they've done. But it's just a fun thing for the community, and I'm hoping that, you know, as the years go by with this, and I've already seen it, this is our second year doing it, mm-hmm. and this year has just, it's grown so much more than it even was last year, and everybody's really having a great time, so.
Now, Doug, about this trail challenge, when we say trail, I think of trail class as manifested in horse shows. Is that the kind of thing where you've got kind of obstacles or things that they have to maneuver through and open gates and, you know, go over bridges and that kind of thing?
Yes, to an extent. What's really neat about this is they've added a little bit from everywhere. You know, there's a sliding stop in there that they have to do. They have to take mail out of a mailbox. They have to ride through, it's a rectangular structure that has ropes hanging down, and so far we haven't had too many people have trouble with that, but probably give a lot of people some trouble. There's a water obstacle, and then for those cowboys that enter the event, there's a little pen that has a couple of steers, and they have to drive the steers in a U to one side of the U, and then drive them back, and then come back out through a gate. So they have to actually open and close two gates as they enter the competition. So
now, I assume that this would be a judged event. In other words, somebody's opinion of the quality of the performance out there. It would have to be subjective, correct, is how it's judged?
Well, I'm the announcer, so I'm going to pass the mic back over to Kathy, and she can tell you how it's judged because she's the head judge.
Okay, head judge, how do you do that? What do you look for?
Well, we look for a few different things. We like to look for style. We like to look for willingness to go forward in the horse, confidence in the horse and the rider, the rider's ability to approach obstacles with patience and safety, of course, being able to complete the task and stay focused. And so they can have extra credit points by putting on, for example, on this particular one, they can put the slicker on instead of putting it over the saddle. So they get a few extra points doing that. But we like to look for just the willingness and the safety and the completion of the task.
Now, is this the first time that any of these competitors will have seen the course? Are they able to go out and walk it or even ride it with their horses ahead of time, or is it the first time?
No one's allowed to enter the arena until they're with the judges for a walkthrough to see the obstacles, but without the horse. The horse does not get to see anything until they're actually in there competing.
Kind of like eventing in that respect. You can walk the the cross-country course in eventing, but you can't take your horse out there with you. So you kind of know what's coming up, but the horse doesn't.
Exactly. And the reason for that is when you're on the trail, you don't really know. Your horse isn't going to know what's around the corner. If there's a deer around the corner, a stump, or something that might frighten or give them a fearful situation, it's something that they need to be able to handle at that point. So that's the whole idea of the trail competition, is that they're approaching obstacles that they haven't seen to see how they handle their fear.
And you don't want them to anticipate you.
Right.
Either. So you want them to just be listening to you, then you'll decide for the team what's going to go on. How do people get chosen to participate? Is it anybody that says, hey, I want to be part of this, or do you screen them somehow?
Basically, Susan, you know, there's a lot of people here this year that signed up last year, and there's a certain initial date when the signups begin. Now, from what I understand from Susan, when I talked to her, Saturday was full almost instantly. And then Friday, you know, you got to take off work for some of these people. So Friday filled up a little bit slower. But I think in just a very, very short time, it was totally booked up.
And it's anybody that wants to try it can?
Right. And we have actually two classes. We have the adult, and then the youth is, help me here, Kathy, is it 13 or 14? It's 13 and below, and we try to make sure all the kids that ride get a prize.
Oh, good.
You know, good. It's a tough course out there.
Well, it sounds like fun. I know I'm supposed to be involved in some fashion on Sunday, I guess, during the finals. Is that what you call it? The finals? The playoffs? Not the playoffs, but the final part of it. The final competition where the best of the best competes.
And I'm going to guess you're probably going to be a judge or something.
Probably. You're going to have to help me on that, Kathy. I haven't judged anything like that before. Well, it sounds like a lot of fun. You know, I wanted to ask you at the first, and I forgot. So we're kind of take a step back here a little bit, looking at the overall picture for you. There are lots of clinicians out there now in the horse world, and you're starting kind of at the beginning of your career as a team, which I pointed out earlier was neat and pretty unusual. How do you see your mission? How do you see yourself fitting in? What are you trying to accomplish?
Well, our goal is to reach people and actually help them work with their horse. So it's not, although we're trainers and we have a training facility and we do train horses for people, our actual goal is to work with the people with their horse so that they can go home and have success and have fun with their horse, because that's why we have them. And so that's what we like to do. And as clinicians traveling around, we're just reaching those people mainly that want to learn how to have a safe time and a fun time with their horse.
Now, is there one thing that keeps popping up that just seems like a repeating theme that is of concern to people with their horses?
I would say probably one of the things that concerns us the most is a lot of people go ahead and they get their first horse and they haven't done their homework. Mm-hmm. You know, we see that so much of the time. If you're going to go buy a new rifle or a new SUV or a new pair of skis, you know, you do some investigation and figure out what item is going to be best for your recreational purpose. In so many instances, people, they go ahead and they get a horse that's green, and then they have a hard time in the beginning. And a lot of people, it's amazing, Rick, are even scared away from horses because they get one and, you know, they saw the movie Spirit. And, you know, it takes a lot of time to build your perfect horse.
Yeah, absolutely. And there's kind of some unrealistic expectations, I think, that some people have. What seems to be emerging as a recurring theme with a lot of people I talk about now, and it's something that we almost didn't talk about for a while, was the fact that so often people are mismatched with a horse. Used to be we'd think, well, okay, this is your horse, you've got a problem, we'll help you resolve that problem with that horse. More often now, I'm hearing people say, well, sometimes it's just not a good match. And either you're going to get hurt before you can learn enough and become good enough to fix that problem, or you're going to just spend all this time that you could be out enjoying riding, you know, in a thing that's labor intensive and that probably is going to be very difficult for you. Sometimes you just have to get a different horse. How do you feel about that, Doug?
One of the things that was really interesting, I think it was in Horse and Rider, and we had a client that was similar. I could ride the horse and do things with the horse, but he couldn't. Because of the type of work he does, he couldn't risk an injury. And we worked on the horse, and the horse got so much better. We had the horse in for, I think, about 60 days. And the horse was doing good, but just still had too much fire under the hood. Mm-hmm. You know, some people want a Chevy Chevette. Some people want a Porsche. Mm-hmm. And Jim wanted a Chevy Chevette. And the thing is that this horse is still coming along, and it's being worked. But there was an article in Horse and Rider, "When Should I Divorce My Horse?" Yeah. And I thought that it was really appropriate. And there is a time, you know, the truth of the matter is you don't pull a big horse trailer like ours with a little tiny pickup truck.
Right.
You know, you have a great big semi that you pull it with. So your horse has to suit the purpose that you have in mind.
Which is so difficult for a lot of people because they have very quickly an emotional connection with the horse or an emotional feeling about the whole thing. And, you know, giving up, the sense in their mind, I'm afraid sometimes, is that I'm giving up on the horse. And I feel guilty about letting the horse down, or this is a failure on my part, and I'm, gosh darn, I'm not somebody who ever backs away from a challenge. There's all kinds of baggage that is associated with the idea of changing horses. So I think it's a good message to send out there that sometimes, I mean, it's nothing to be ashamed of. It's just plain being smart, trying to use your time wisely, because none of us has unlimited time. I, for one, want to get the most out of the time I spend with my horses.
Right. We do find that it is difficult for people to do it. They commit themselves to the animal. They fall in love with them. They make it a part of their family. They want it to work so bad. But sometimes you just have to look at them and say, well,
it's not one of your kids.
Maybe exactly. It's not. And they're a big animal. I mean, 1,200 pounds of animal with someone that's not capable of handling a situation, you know, that can be a wreck waiting to happen. So you just got to kind of let them look at the whole picture, and sometimes they'll see it and sometimes they won't.
Okay. Yeah, and hopefully they, you know, if you can place that horse with in a better situation where it's a better match with another person, could be a better deal for the horse.
Right.
So, I mean, that's one thing you can throw out there, too. Well, you guys are fascinated. Do you have a website we can mention for folks?
We do. It's OregonHorseTrainers.com.
OregonHorseTrainers.com. My guests have been Kathy and Doug Voschel. And I think I pronounced your name right.
You did. You did a great job.
Is that French?
It's French-Canadian.
It's French-Canadian. Okay. Thank you, folks, for being on the show today.
Thank you, Rick.
And there you have it, my friends. Hope you've enjoyed our program today. Remember my website, thehorseshow.com. If it's not convenient for you to listen to our radio programs on our great affiliate stations or Sirius XM, or if you can't get our TV show on RFD TV, well, there is another option, and that's on-demand streaming through our website, thehorseshow.com. We redesigned it this year from the ground up, and all of our content is now hosted through YouTube, so you can get it on any device that gets YouTube. Have fun, ride safely, and I'll see you next time. For The Horse Show, I'm Rick Lamb.